All right, folks, welcome to our second service. So we'll begin our service with singing. Let's sing Dwelling in Beulah Land. Let's sing Dwelling in Beulah Land.
On every hand, thousand deer and kings of earth in vain. Never my love, thou hast known.
great singing folks.
All right, so young people, college career, is it?
Yes.
Follow the man. I mean, follow Pastor Mass.
That's not right. All right, for the rest of you, take your Bibles and turn to Daniel 3. Daniel 3. So I'm going to tell you, as a pastor, it is wonderful to see so many college and career in our church. Amen. That is a blessing. It is a blessing. And praise the Lord for it. And you can quiz them about what they're going to learn after. All right. Wasn't that a wonderful service at 9? That was great. And so good to see so many visitors out too. And great singing. And isn't it wonderful just to remember what Christ has done? He is alive. He is risen. All right. So I know last week the ladies were downstairs. So men, the spotlight is now on you. Because I have some questions. And Ramo is like, I know I should have took notes. I know. All right. Daniel, we looked at, who did we look at last week? Like real quick, we looked over, there was four. Who were they? Well done. Does anyone remember what Daniel's name means? No, that's what they changed his name to. Roger, there's no prize. But I appreciate the enthusiasm. But what does Daniel's name mean in Hebrew? God is in it. God is in his name. God, yeah, actually, it's the very first part. God is my judge. That's okay. It's okay. Okay. So, yes, and so his name was called, changed to Belteshazzar, which is Bel, protects his life. We looked at a little bit last week how Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach came into Babylon, and the Babylonians were really trying to assimilate them into their culture. And so they gave them new names. And not only their culture, or part of the aspect of their culture, was their worship of many gods. So that's why they gave names that would correlate with their gods. All right. Though these guys all stayed faithful to serving the one and true and living God, all right? And then now Daniel's the main character that I really talked about, but that's right. Shadrach is the moon god. Meshach is Aku, which is a heathen, another one of the gods. And then Abednego, a servant of Nego. All right, so how old was Daniel and his buddies when they got captured?
17 years old.
17? Anyone else got a better answer? 15? Do I get 16? Yeah. Most say 17, but there's some scholars say between 15 and 17. So whatever, it's in that age bracket, all right? So then what does the word purpose mean? Because we looked at it last time, that Daniel purposed in his heart. Determined. Contentional. Committed. They were committed. All right, so Daniel chapter 3. And we'll start in verse number 1. Nebuchadnezzar the king made an image of gold whose height was 60 cubits and the breadth thereof 6 cubits. He set up in the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king sent to gather together the princes, the governors, the captains, the judges, the treasurers, the counselors, the sheriffs, and all the rulers of the provinces to come to dedication of the image which Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. Then the princes, the governors, the captains, the judges, the treasurers, the counselors, the sheriffs, and all the rulers of the provinces were gathered together unto the dedication of the image that Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. And they stood before the image, and Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Then a herald cried aloud to all, to you is commanded, O people, nations, and language, that at the time ye hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, palstry, dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king hath set up. And whosoever falleth not down and worshipeth shall the same hour be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. All right, so before we dive right in here, the Bible, I've mentioned this numerous times, but I keep wanting to say it because in our world, our society, we hear the Bible tore down all the time. the Bible is the truth. There's no error, okay? We can absolutely understand the Bible to be true. Our culture does not embrace it. Our culture tries to tear it down. It mocks, it tears down. If you tell someone, I mean, not everyone, but there's numerous folks who would mock that you would follow the Bible. We're better than that now. We don't need that. All right, that's often part of it. You can trust this book for the rest of your lives. The rest of your lives. And eternity. That's right. We'll be good then. We won't need preaching every Sunday to get us back on course. But the idea is that it is perfect. It never changes. And, you know, we see here in this portion of scriptures, boys, right? 15, 17. Boys who believed it to be true and how God blessed them through their lives. And they get to heaven, and if we were able to interview them now, they'd say, don't go away from the truth. Stay at the truth, all right? And you know, unfortunately, people, and I know people who at one time were in church, they believed the Bible, now they don't. Yeah. That's sad. It's heartbreaking. I'm going to give you a little insight on a pastor. I know that people come and go in churches, but a pastor will always miss those people who go. I'm saying for those who are here, don't ever think like, pastor only cares about those who are gone. No. But there's a part of a pastor's heart that like aches that people aren't there, that they miss out. And it's not because I think as a pastor I'm the best preacher. No, but because God allowed you to be part of this flock that I'm supposed to guide. That's why it hurts a little bit. No, it's a joyful pain, shall we say, when they move on to another church, God directs them to another place. Well, I'm glad they're there. But when they leave and they don't go to any church, it hurts. All right. And I think it hurts more than the pastor. I think it hurts other sheep too. But at any rate, so I mention that again because these guys, from young to they're old, they obeyed God's word. All right. So we read of a statue in verse number one, right? It's created. This is created to worship. So I remember going to Bible college. I remember hearing about, and when I was a kid in church at First Baptist Church in Mount Pearl, we'd have missionary hour. You know, remember those big books you open? You couldn't wait for the teacher to pull the, you know, open. You know, type of stories and missionary stories. So I remember those growing up, and they would have pictures of idols and things. You know, when I first actually saw an idol is when I moved to Brampton. We were looking for a house, and I saw more than one. And I understand that people make idols in their life. I understand it. But I mean, like, religiously, this is their idol they worship. I don't know how many houses we went to. I think it was like 400. It wasn't, but it was a lot. We went to a lot of houses, and there was houses that we went into that just had a worship room. Incense was burning. Smoke was coming out of that thing. I remember one in particular, not far from where I live now. And as soon as I walked downstairs, I could see, like, I was going in the mist, you know. Go down to all the candles, and there was someone inside the prayer, like that guy told us it was a prayer room, but idols everywhere. I'm like, what? I mean, I heard about this, but I've never seen it before. And these idols, you know, they were from that to like maybe a foot. There was nothing bigger than 2 feet tall. But this statue here, this was big. So how tall do you think this is?
60 cubits.
60 cubits? So what do you think that's in feet? From what I read from scholars, and I wasn't there, but it's 125 feet tall. So it's tall. And then it was 6 cubits wide, so 12 and a half feet wide. So that's really hard to miss when it's on a plane, right? It's flat ground. Everywhere around is flat, all right? So just outside of the city. So then verse 2 tells about the princes, who were the counselors, governors, captains. So the captains were military leaders. Judges were lawmakers, treasurers. That's, you know, they were involved with the money. The counselors there were lawyers. The sheriffs were like law enforcement. So just the idea is it gives us a little bit like how we would see people today.
Same government
as today. That's right. And then all the rulers, that's just accompanying everybody, you know, from like mayors or towns leaders or whatever, right? So as we continue through this passage, they're mentioned a couple times, the groups that are there. Then it's the worship. A bunch of musical instruments were used in this worship. Some were strings, some were wind, some was a drum. And once that music started, the multitude that were gathered on the plains of Dura, they were to bow. So this is idol worship, right? Plain simple. It's idol worship. I personally believe that this idol looked like Nebuchadnezzar. Yeah. Nebuchadnezzar was one proud, arrogant, crazy man. All right? And he really thought, later on in Daniel, he was judged because he thought he was a god. Yeah. Right? I mean, he thought, I built this great empire of Babylon. All right? So I believe it was in his likeness. That doesn't say it there, but that's just my own personal take. So you would think, you don't bow. So you get in trouble. You break a law, right? Fair enough. There's a law. But you think about it, so no bowing is not that you get extra taxes, not that you get yourself put up in public shame or you go to the jail or you know, whatever. You burn, right? I mean, that's crazy. This kind of reflects how crazy Nebuchadnezzar is. And he says, whosoever falleth not, he didn't say it, it was the heralder who said this, but it came from the king, falleth not down and worship shall the same hour be cast in the midst of the fiery furnace, burning fire furnace. I mean, crazy. I mean, and it, so, and again, that's part of the reason why I think it was in his image, because he expected everyone to bow to him. But it wasn't quick with the sword. It was agony. And then he had a viewing station. Talk about a psychopath. I mean, he had a place to sit and watch you burn. I mean, this is... And I tell you all this because it really then makes how well these boys stood up for truth, how much courage they had. That this is the crazy they had to deal with, and yet they still follow God, okay? So has anyone ever here been burned by fire? Even a little bit? Matthew, a little bit. Yeah. I burned him. I mean, he got burned at home, but. All right. So I remember this one time. This was before Hannah was born, I think. We went to visit my father-in-law and uncle's, Michelle's uncle's cottage in Cape Breton. Beautiful place. The guys who went with us past summer on vacation, they went there. Beautiful view of the ocean and things. And so Hannah, or I believe it was just Matthew, Nathaniel, and Emily. Was that right, Michelle? Can you remember? Yeah. Okay. So we were living in Newfoundland at the time. We came across the ferry, and we spent a week there hanging out and stuff. So my father-in-law had just bought a brand-new barbecue. Now, this is where I should have stopped and had some serious questions. He put it together. Okay. So I get the burgers out. I ask my father-in-law, is the barbecue good to go? Yes, my son, it's good to go. All right, so getting everything ready. I turn on the valve, just let the gas go. Then I go to the barbecue, it says on, to turn it on the burners, right? You know the setting? You got a few barbecuers here, so you put it on the setting to start, right? You would never put the setting all the way up on full blast and then try to light it because that would go wrong, right? Right? You get me? Okay. So I turn on the valve. I put it on the start position. And he said, and to me, this was new because I was using the old technology. You throw a light, a match in. This one, you just hit the clicker, right? This is, how old are you, Hannah? You're 17, right? So this was almost 20 years ago. All right. So I hit the clicker. And then I saw a big ball of fire. And my wife laughs. She's the one who would laugh. And so I hit it, poof. I don't think I had any eyebrows for a while. My unibrow disappeared. Didn't have any hair in my hands or my arm. I think I might have had a longer shirt on, so it only went so far. And, all the frizzies came falling down off my face. I got a little minor burn. There was nothing serious. I just put in cold water. It was fine. And then my father-in-law comes racing out of the cottage and said, oh, Mark, I forgot to tell you. When he put it together, the star position was full blast. The highest setting, he just hadn't messed up. Well, he remembered after the fact. All right? I think he did it on purpose. But anyway, he still enjoyed the burgers, and I looked bald for a while. But the reality is, it was just a minor burn, and it didn't feel very nice. Now, the shrink, the face hair didn't matter. That didn't hurt me. But the idea is that this guy, Nebuchadnezzar, would put people in a fiery furnace, not to bow, and he would sit back and watch. Sick, sick guy, all right? So music plays, verse 8, so that it talks about they should worship, verse 8, wherefore at that time, certain Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews. They spake and said to the king Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. Thou, O king, has made a decree that every man shall hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, sackbut, psaltery, dulcimer, and all kinds of music shall fall down and worship the golden image. And whosoever faileth not down and worship, that he should be cast in the midst of the burning fiery furnace. There are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. So this is a really good point for us, is that when we determine to serve God, there will be people who will attack. These Chaldeans, they weren't very happy with these three guys, okay? And it's interesting. Have not regarded thee. What do you think that means? Defying, yeah. So don't respect you. That would be a huge deal for Nebuchadnezzar, right? He thought he deserved all the respect. And they were making light of his commands. Oh, whatever. That's what these Chaldeans were trying to push on the king. They serve not our gods. And actually, that charge is true, right? They didn't. They didn't serve their gods. The Babylonians had a great host of gods, like tons of them. But they were not accepting, these three Jewish boys were not accepting of their religious system. So you know what they were doing? They were pushing back on that simulation part. No, I have to simulate in the culture here as best I can. I'm not assimilating in your religious world realm. That's not happening. Nope. Nope, no. Okay? But that would have bothered the king, though, right? Because the king put them through this University of Babylon to be like Babylonians, and now they're not, so that's making him upset. And then, nor worship the gold image which thou hast set up. And that's true, too, and that's simple enough to figure out. So down in verse number 13. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury, commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these men before the king. So we see how proudful this man is very quickly. He gets upset. They disobeyed me. How dare they? And I don't know if you've ever been around someone who gets mad and you see the anger in their face. It's definitely not a fun experience. All right, and that's what's happening to them. And then Nebuchadnezzar, his rage, and Nebuchadnezzar spake, verse 14, said unto them, is it true? Is it true? O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, do ye not serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up? Now, if ye be ready, that at that time ye hear the sound of all the instruments, cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the image which I have made. Well, so if they did it, they weren't going to the fiery furnace, right? I think in his own mind, he's being super gracious right now. I'm giving you a second chance. I think that's how he thinks. But if ye worship not, ye shall be cast the same hour into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And in this last part, this really is the kicker. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? Whoa, you think you're hot stuff. Right, he really thought, I'm the guy. I'm arrogant. And that last statement, I believe that statement was made to intimidate them. I've destroyed, because he's thinking in his mind, I've destroyed Jerusalem. I took out your God. Now, what he didn't understand is that God didn't reside in Jerusalem. It wasn't that situation. But that's what he's thinking. And all the other gods, all the other nations I've overcome, I've destroyed them. Who is your God? You're not going to be able to do that. Now, we witness like one of the most greatest stand fast firm events in the entire Bible. Okay? So when I read this, try to imagine. All right, use your imagination. I know it's 11, after 11:30. You're starting to get hungry. Your stomach's starting to growl. But in your own mind, think about this as they respond. All right, use your imagination. Verse number 16. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that ye will not serve we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up." So these guys knew who they were dealing with before they said this. Like, they didn't show up in the court and say, "Oh, Nebuchadnezzar, are you a nice guy? We don't know you." No, they're brought into the king. They know what's supposed to happen. They're supposed to bow. They stood firm. They would never. They say, "We'll never bow." Now, do you think they might have had like dry mouth and sweaty hands? Do you think they were nervous? I think they were, because I would be nervous. You know, it's right. What they say is right, but that doesn't mean it's always easy to say. Right? This needs to be said. And the reality is, these guys had a relationship with Jehovah that gave them the inner strength to say what they said, and they stood firm. Now, I do believe they made this decision long before this day. They made that decision to stand fast, that they would not bow, long before. So in previous verses, it tells us that they were involved with the province of Babylon. Okay? Daniel's not mentioned here. We see Daniel more involved with the entirety of the empire. So he could, I think he was on business afar, myself, for the king. Whereas Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they were stuck in the province. They were serving the king in the province. They were provincial leaders, if you want to use that terminology. Between the government and the province. I mean, I don't know if they call it a province, but I think that's the best way of describing it for us, okay? So they were in government. So they would have heard about the king's command long before this came about. I mean, they lived in Babylon, and Dura was on the plain where it was the idol. They probably saw it constructed. Who knows what they actually did. Maybe they signed off on, yes, this goal is going to create this image. We don't know exactly what they did in Babylon, but they knew. So before they walked out that day to go, and I think that's one reason why we're told all these leaders were there, because they fell in amongst the group, they said, "We're not going to bow." I mean, those guys knew Nebuchadnezzar. They knew how crazy this guy was. I mean, so let's just say they were 17. When they entered the University of Babylon. They had 3 years, right? That's chapter one. We saw it was a three-year program. And at the end of the three-year program, Nebuchadnezzar says, "Oh, you're smart. You're actually 10 times smarter than anybody else in this graduation class." All right? So that's 20. Let's just say it's a couple of more years. Let's even say it's 5. We don't know exactly how old, but they're still young men. Like, they're not like in 45, 50 or nothing like that. I mean, these guys are young, and they're like, "Nope. We're not going to bow." I mean, I've actually thought about it. So, "Oh, look, a shiny rock." When they blew the whistles, so I wouldn't get in trouble, but I'm not going to serve it, right? My shoelace needs to be done up. You know, whatever. I mean, we can find excuses to do it, but these guys, they made a statement, right? "No, we're not going to do it. We're not going to bow." And in verse 19, then. So he was already mad before. "Then was Nebuchadnezzar full of fury, and the form of his visage, as his face was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego." I wonder, when he found out about these guys coming, he's like, "Oh, these are good guys. Like, Shadrach, Meshach, these are good guys. I don't want to hurt them. I'm going to give them another chance." But then when they, in his mind, blow off the chance, then he's vicious. All right? "And therefore he spake and commanded that they should heat the furnace 1 7 times more than it was wont to be heated." Like he was mad. Again, he thinks he was very merciful to give him a second chance, and but that didn't matter. Now they're gonna get it. They're gonna get it. Now, have you ever made a good decision when you're angry?
No.
No. Never. It's never happened to me that I made a really sound biblical choice when I'm furious. No, not at all. So the king loses his marbles. He says, get that furnace roaring. Now a little bit more, but 7 times more than usual. You know what he's saying? I want these guys to fry. That's what he's saying. I want them to fry, like instantly. As soon as they get close, I want them to, poof, be dead. All right? And secular sources tell us that, not at this moment, but it was known that the human fire pit, because really that's what it was known to shoot flames dozens of feet above when it was roaring going. So we don't know exactly how it was designed, but we know it wasn't made of wood, right? No wood involved with the fire. This was a rock mason thing. I've seen some descriptions of where there's a bit of a rant that comes up and they would throw in the people, and then Nebuchadnezzar and his men, who like to watch people burn, would be sitting, and there was an opening in the fire that they could see in. So that makes sense with the story as well, because he could see in. He wasn't looking down. He would see right in. So at any rate, in they go. And verse 22 tells us that his greatest men, that therefore the king's command was urgent, the furnace exceedingly hot, and the flame of the fire slew those men that took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You know, and that was his mighty men, the men that were available at that time, the mighty men in the army. They took them through, men, and they died because it was so hot. You know, immediately, dead. And so they're thrown in, and it didn't take long for them to figure out something's up. All right. Then Nebuchadnezzar, the king, was astonished and rose up in haste and spake and did say unto his counselors, did not we cast in 3 men bound in the midst of the fire? And they answered and said unto the king, true, O king. And he answered and said, lo, I see 4 men loose walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. Then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spake and said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, ye servants of the Most High God, come forth and come hither. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came forth out of the midst of the fire. And then the princes, the governors, and the captains, and king's counselors, being gathered together, saw that these men, upon whose bodies the fire had no power, nor was any hair on their heads singed, neither their coats changed, nor smell of fire had passed on them. So we could talk a whole about the Son of God, fourth one walking in the fire with them, okay? But that, it's really important, but I'm really focused on the 3 guys, all right? So he sees that something's wrong. He admits that that's the Son of God, which is a big admittance for that guy. Okay, so he walks close, calls them out, because they're seeing something miraculous here. Can you remember just a few moments before? This wasn't like an hour later. Just a few moments before, they said, if we burn, we burn. But our God can, but if we burn, we burn. Now their God is doing something miraculous. And he's like, come out, come out. I thought about this week as I was studying and going over these notes again. I'm like, why would I want to come out? You're crazy. Really? Nebuchadnezzar was a madman. Like, at least here I'm in safe. I'm safe in the fire. Maybe that's a message sometime. But anyways, you know, they come out and we see how God protected them. I mean, they're not, their bodies were immune to the effects of the fire. They should be covered with burns, right? I mean, should be covered. No hair was singed. I mean, my father-in-law trying to kill me. No, he didn't try to kill me. But the barbecue story, it's a true story. I mean, that was quick, right? It was just one big fireball. Poof. And all the hairs on my hands and my face were gone. All right, this fire killed my men. No smell of smoke on them. So I don't know, like, where you're from originally, if this ever happened. But growing up in Newfoundland, we would be always going to the beach to have a bonfire, right? Having fires on the beach and having a great time. And then I'd come home, and my mom be like, so how was the campfire? I'm like, there for a while, I thought my mom knew everything. Okay. Like, how do you know? I never said that. Just, oh, it was good. It was good, you know. Being a teenager, playing it cool. Oh, yeah, it was fine. It's fine. Well, it was later on I figured out why she knew, because we smelled like it. Right? Around burning old tar and everything. We reeked, you know. And Mom's like, well, I knew you were at the fire, but she's like, I could smell you. It wasn't until later I figured it out. But no smell of it, even. I mean, that's incredible. And no, and the clothes were fine. The garments weren't burned. Nothing was burnt. I mean, and all this came because those three lads had said, we commit, we purpose to do what is right. And like I said, I believe they made that decision long before the workmen hauled up that golden image and got it stationary and stuff. This is me surmising because there's no scripture to tell us, but I think they talked about it. Do you know what's going to happen, Shadrach? Yeah. Yeah. What are we going to do? We're not going to bow. We know that we're going to get dead, right? We're going to die. That's fine. I really believe they knew everything was going on. They were in the government. They knew that these processes were taking place. They knew what was coming down the track, but they said, no, we are going to stand for truth. And the king was changed by their stand for faithfulness. And then Nebuchadnezzar spake and said, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who have sent his angel and delivered his servants that trusted in him and have changed the king's word and yielded their bodies that they might not serve nor worship any god except their own God. So this is not Nebuchadnezzar coming to Jesus moment. He's just recognizing that there is a God and that this is these guys' God. And he goes on to say, if anybody says anything about their God, he was going to kill them, cut them in pieces, and their houses shall be made a dunghill. Because there's no other God that can deliver after this sort. And he was absolutely right. There is no other God that can do what happened there. He's absolutely right there. All right. And that only happened because those three lads said, we will not bow. If they would have bowed, Nebuchadnezzar would never have given God the glory. You know, he was a heathen still, absolutely. But he gave God the glory. God deserved it. All right. So we have to make a decision in our hearts and lives to do what is right. We have to make that choice. Today, tomorrow, the next day. It's not like it's a one-time thing when I was 13, I said I was going to do what's right. No, you got to continually commit. I do wonder sometimes if they were like, oh, maybe we should, maybe just to get. No, we're going to stand fast. We have to step out by faith and follow God. So there's a family that I know really well. And the guy, he was my Sunday school teacher growing up, and he told me the story about how his parents escaped East Germany. And actually, before Germany became East and West, his father had went to Germany, married a lady from Germany, and then the war broke out. And he was an American, and he was always being spied on by, you know, Secret Service or whatever, the secret police over there. And so he joined the German army. First chance he got, he surrendered and was in a prison camp most of the war. Then after the war, he couldn't go back to the United States with his family because he was German. So he got sent back to Germany. And then when the country got divided, he was in East Germany and, you know, West, they wanted to be in West, but they were in the East. So they took a step of faith. They're like, we're not going to live here. This is wrong. This is wicked, the system and things. And they drove to the border. Now, to us, you know, that's no big deal. You drive to the border and go across the border, right? Well, there it was a big deal because you weren't allowed to leave the country unless you had special papers to leave the country. So they got to the border. They're praying like crazy to get across the border. They don't know how this is going to happen. And they pull up, and there's four cars in ahead of them, and they're the fifth car in this line. And some soldiers walk by them, and they figured they're caught. And they stand behind their car, looking the other way, and then they see this officer going from one car to the next. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is their car. He rolls down his window. He's about ready to pass. They do have passports. Give him the passport. He goes, nope. He said, we just got a call from headquarters. These five cars go across. No one knows. Go. You don't have to show us your paperwork. Go. They didn't have any paperwork. They're not supposed to leave East Germany, but someone from headquarters said the next five cars can go, no questions asked. That's amazing. You know, and then the family got to West Germany, then they got to the United States again. And it was his parents that happened with, and he ended up becoming one of my Sunday school teachers. He ended up teaching in Bible college out in America somewhere. And, you know, just amazing testimony. But it all started with parents that, hey, we're not going to stand for this. We're going to trust God. Woo! I mean, that's incredible. I mean, they could have lost their lives. I mean, that would be the worst, but they would definitely went to jail. You know, the family would have been ripped apart. So it's amazing when we, and I know that's a really extreme circumstance, I get that, but it just shows us, and hey, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that was a really extreme circumstance too. But it just shows that we need to stand firm. So some applications for us. Evil men are not the final judge. Amen? Amen? Evil men are not the final judge. God is the final authority of all men. Nebuchadnezzar thought he was the final authority. He was not. He was not a righteous king at that moment. And there are many wicked individuals in our day, as it was in their day. There's people who abuse others, treat others in wicked ways. They prey on the vulnerable, to deceive, to gain. The list goes on and on, all right? We live in an endlessly wicked world. Growing up in Newfoundland, there was a place called Mount Cashel Orphanage. I don't know if any of you ever heard of it. It was a Catholic orphanage run by some brothers who did some extremely wicked things to the boys that were there. And I remember, I was a teenager later, teenage years, and I remember them taking these priests and brothers and putting them on trial, and they died before they even got to trial. And people were furious. Well, they're going to stand before the righteous judge. Amen. They're not going to escape judgment. You know, God will have the final say. Sometimes it's here on earth, but it always will be in heaven. God will judge, and he will judge justly. He will do that. So that's one. Evil men are not the final judge. It often costs to stand firm for the Lord, but he'll take care of his own. He can cost us. Not all the time, but sometimes. You might feel pressure because you won't do a certain thing. You might lose some friends or position for standing firm for the Lord. We need to continue standing with him. All right? He blessed others. He can bless us. He'll take care of us. I know of a family that were in Russia, and they faced a lot of problems there as missionaries. This is really recent. And they were pushed back by the locals and things. It was really hard. Their apartment building burnt down. They lost everything in the fire. And they ended up having to come back from Russia because of the pressures and stuff they were facing. They moved back to the United States. They ended up taking a small church in Newfoundland, where I'm from. And, you know, so they learned Russian and stuff, obviously living in Russia. Well, you know what has occurred since they left Russia and came to Newfoundland? It was the war between Russia and Ukraine. And Canada's been taking a lot of Ukrainian refugees. And the city that they're in is Corner Brook. It welcomed a bunch of Ukrainians, but no one in the city of 30,000 people could speak Russian except for them. Isn't that an amazing opportunity? And the day that the city was welcomed, they were there interpreting for everybody. Talk about making new contacts and, you know, when the government, the locals and stuff. Hey, yeah, you might go through a hard time, but God's got a plan. God's got a plan to help you. He wants the best for you. He has a plan. And so just keep moving forward. And then the third one is good friends are absolutely important. Good friends are absolutely important. I firmly believe they made that decision to stand firm, and they told one another, and they were there to help one another out. I mean, I know three is not a crowd and probably the great multitude, but they felt better about it, having a good friend. Don't worry, Shadrach, I got you. Meshach, we're okay. You know, the idea is that they're there for each other, and that's so, so important. And the friends that we have really determine the direction we'll go for life until we make newer friends or get rid of the old friends or whatever the case is. So we need to make sure that we're going forward. As a youth pastor 20 odd years ago, I can think of a number of young people who were in our youth group who said, I believe the Lord's called me to ministry. And in the same youth group, we had a fella who wasn't like doing anything super wicked, but his pursuit was money. And I'm going to tell you right now, he influenced that crowd for money rather than serve Jesus. It was sad to see. And now I look back, and it's been a long time now since I was their youth pastor, and just to see, I'm not saying all their lives are a mess, some of them are, but the idea is that they missed an opportunity that God gave them. You know, and then I'm thankful to tell you about other folks that I know who have been excited about serving Jesus Christ, and they've influenced others to serve the Lord as well. They're the good stories. They're the ones that are encouraging, and let's be that type of friend that we encourage. Well, we'll tell them the truth, you know, but we're not going to discourage them from serving Jesus. We're definitely not going to influence them to stay away from church. We want them to serve, all right? So the decision lays before you. Are you going to bow to the idols? Are you going to bow to the culture of this world? Or are you going to stand firm for the Lord, for what's right, and what's going to honor what's going to honor God like those lads did so many years ago? So choose friends that will aid you in that walk, all right? We don't hear about these three lads anymore. All right? We don't hear no more. I do believe we get to heaven, we'll meet them. I believe all my heart they're saved individuals. If you're not saved, you wouldn't say, no, I'm not going to bow. You know, we'll meet them. But their courage and their willingness to stand firm publicly in a really wicked time should really impact us today. Thousands of years later, you can go back on the board there and you'll find the Babylonian Empire and see how far we are from then. And it's amazing how their lives then can impact our lives today. Because we serve the same God. We serve the same God. Their God's no different than our God. They serve the same God. So you need a purpose in your heart today that you're going to stand firm in your public life. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for this time. Help us to be standing firm for you. Thank you for these three lads. Lord, thank you for their testimony and their encouragement to us today. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You're dismissed. I should have zoomed in on you.